Okay, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our new session of Swiss Talks. And today we have a great man, great entrepreneur, professor, lecturer, and a good friend, Professor Rob David from Artwork. Welcome, Rob.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. And really great to be here and part of your Global Management and Leadership course, actually. Yeah.
Amazing. Rob is a sustainable marketer, innovator, experienced professional and business modeler, and he's an Earth Charter endorser. And we'll go in a minute into these amazing things he's doing. Let me just give you an insight about what he did in the past. So he started his career as account manager for a company called Gispen International. Then he went into Steelcase Company, where he was a dealer development manager. And then he managed to get into the company, one of the H3 Rose, company named H3 Rose Crafting Customer-Centric Companies. Amazing. That must be amazing. And he's a lecturer of higher education, accounting manager, connecting business with education, and he teaches so much more. He also organizes international weeks and experiences for his students at Avans Hogeschool in the Netherlands. And since 20 years, he's the owner and main promoter of Artwork Solutions. So Rob, amazing. Let me read what Artwork is doing. Actually, Artwork Solutions is focusing on personal leadership and career training material. Their strength is about creating training modules and the combination of elements of Myers and Briggs that we know from the leadership course, Jung and talent development, based on experienced and proven coaching format. So once more, Rob, welcome to our session. Please, tell us something. Tell us something what you do, the magic you do at Artwork Solution.
Yeah, you know, it's at Artwork Solutions. It's a company which started in the year 2000 when I became by a management buyout, and I became the, let's say, the dealer of an office furniture company. And it is really weird, because if you talk about business modeling and changing your business, creating, let's say, a value for your customers, the Network Solutions changed in a certain moment from a office furniture company to a company which was doing a lot of things, but not selling office furniture anymore. And so this is quite weird, but maybe you know the business modeling principles, the canvas. You try to bring your complete company on one paper and describing this paper. And I found that my own specialties were not in selling furniture, but were much more in creating value to a company or to persons. So it changed a little bit. And at the same time, I tried to start working in education. It's about 12 years ago now. Working in education, because I had some students, bachelor students, they presented something and I said, well, if this is education, please make me a lecturer, because I will explain them what you have to do to become a professional in the real world. And I started for 2 days a week, and it grew to almost full time. And nowadays I make a combination between, on one hand, being a lecturer, a professor, and on the other hand, having my own company, which is a great experience for students, actually. And in my own company, I changed, let's say, the value to customers, because I heard something about sustainability, and this is a long time ago, actually. And I thought, what is sustainability? What can we do, and what's going to happen? And as you told just in the introduction, I became a member of the Earth Charter, which is, let's say, a paper document stated in 1999, became official in the year 2000. And it's talking about the real values we should use in our daily life, the real values to survive in this world, to have a balance in economy, to have a balance in ecology, to have a balance in having peace and harmless living together, which is, I think, nowadays really in the news every day, I should say. And these values were translated in this document, and I became member of a very specific network, which was mainly filled with people who were in governments, who were prime ministers, our queen, for the older people in the rest, for example, Margaret Thatcher, Gorbachev in the USA, in the USSR, all these kind of people. It was a weird network, but it was really a learningful experience. And if you take a look behind me, you see the global goals. And I can tell you, in 2015, the climate top in Paris changed the world a little bit, because then people realized that we really have to change our habits to survive this world. Yeah. And then, you know, a special moment came, because if you are looking at these, let's say, this direction and these people who try to promote what we have to do to survive in this world, and if you are an entrepreneur, you're looking for new chances, you are looking for opportunities to create value to your customers, when I explain it like that, to create value to your customers. And the value I expected, which should be very, very important, was the value of, you know, finding a balance in a company between making money and making impact. So the economic value, and we're all known about the economic value, you're learning all the financials, but there's something more. And I expected in, let's say, end 2015, beginning 2016, I expected there should be a better balance between the economic part and the social part in running a company, in leading a company.
Yeah.
And the manager is looking very good, let's say, is looking very good to the insights, which are all the figures. But the leader try to bring his people up front, in front of him, and bringing those people to those employees to the next level. And that next level might be creating impact. And what we see now is that companies are expected to create more impact, not just making money. And in the meantime, I was looking, as I told you, stopping with office furniture, looking for something else, but bringing value, and bringing value to my customers was more and more coaching people, coaching entrepreneurs, coaching teams. And during the last years, I developed a training program which makes it possible to do tests. It can be the Myers-Briggs test, MBTI. It can be another test. But let's say giving insights to the individual to create better teams and to create a better vision or a mission to the company. And you can do it with the best team. So there is, you know, lots of issues passed in the last years. But the main thing is, and that's what I found out personally, that I really like to work on the fields, the crossing edge, actually, of sustainability, yeah, of entrepreneurship, the second one, and the third one is of innovation of business models, innovation of companies, innovation of teams. And those three are always crossing my path, actually, whatever I do. And this is really great to do, and that's why I changed my company, why I, let's say, changed my company into doing a hobby, doing the things you really like, doing the things you are talented in, and liking and talented in is a great combination if you like to travel and you're talented or experienced in doing international business. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you create the combination and you use your talents, that's my experience, but it's what I explain to the people who are doing my training sessions. And this is what I'm doing now on an international base, helping individuals, helping educational institutes, and helping companies to create better people, create better teams, and create sustainable mission and vision in the company.
What do you believe, or what is your experience in facing internationalization when you meet people from different countries, different cultures, also languages? So how do they fit in an organization that is maybe more Western cultured than their own culture?
Well, first of all, part of the experience is that people who are in the process of internationalization, so the international account managers or people like the members from a network called BusyNet, they are the people who are willing to meet other people in other cultures. So this might be a little bit different from the people in, let's say, the home-based offices and home-based university teams. So that's one difference. But to explain one, let's say, bad experience in starting in an international environment was the question of my former boss in the Netherlands, and at least the invitation to become the managing director of that company in the Netherlands. And the only thing I had to do was visit the headquarters in France, in Paris, have one meeting with the HR manager to get it confirmed by the headquarters. And the biggest mistake I made, and it's a very, very good learning opportunity in this learning experience, actually, the biggest mistake I made was that I didn't take into account the cultural differences between the Netherlands and France. And I came in the office and we had a very nice chat. And then I said, just in my enthusiasm, I'm so, so really happy. I'm so happy that I will become the boss of the Netherlands, the manager of the Netherlands. And then she said, well, I have to make that decision. And this is a cultural thing, because yes, my boss decided, he asked for an advice, he followed the rules, and he said, you have to go to France. They will, no problem, they will give you the job, but they have to decide it. And in my opportunistic Dutch, always talking way, and you know, very, is it a word, brutal? You just say what you think. I said what I thought, and it was the biggest mistake I could make in that process.
So it didn't eventually you got the job?
No. I was not the right person. It was her advice. So I think that's a learning experience in difference in cultural experiences. And it's a learningful experience, but there are so many differences, especially when you are Dutch. We used to travel all over the world for ages. We did a lot of wrong things, actually bad things. Nowadays, it is mentioned every day in the Netherlands, actually, but we are traders. We will trade. But if you, in earlier days, if you trade from an historical perspective, then you come to tell what the others have to do. And in this case, it's completely different. Nowadays, it's completely different. And the difference will mean that if you really take a look into account what the differences are, then it's really great to work together, because you have to adapt every time a little bit to the other country, the other person or people you meet. But it's so, so learningful. It's so interesting. Because at the end, and that's what I am doing with my profiling based on MBTI on my bricks, and only 16 profiles, and based on talent scans, you see differences in areas in Europe. So there are lots of differences, but you have to find them. You have to use the right way to act, actually.
Seeing now the world, the economy changing all over the world, really completely upside down of when you and me went to school, right? So the population has doubled, not to say tripled almost. We are on that way. And there are more powers playing a role for the same stake. So how do you foresee, what do you think are we going to face basically in economics? China coming up, the four tigers being more stronger, America having some turmoil inside their own economy, you know. 1 week before the COVID-19, Trump was almost re-elected, you know, because everything was going well in terms of facts and figures. And today, you know, he faces exactly 180 degrees of what was the situation before. So how do you see the world developing? And are we doing the right things? Are we teaching the right things at universities and business schools to face this change?
Several things, I guess. But first of all, the old-fashioned way of teaching is telling the student what he has to do on a certain moment. And I think at this moment, we have to teach you as a student or a business person already, we have to teach you how to react on all these differences and changes and so on. And I see a world which is reacting, and companies or leaders which are reacting more and more faster and faster. So the long term research projects will become more and more the short term and short cyclic research projects. So trial and error will come more and more. And on the same time, you see, if you take a look at the US and if you take a look at, let's say, China, but the area over there, and you'll take a look at Europe, you see that the US is losing grip in the world, again, the economy. I feel that the Chinese, Japanese, the Asian people are more and more taking over very strategic positions already in Europe for years. So this might have a very big change that between, let's say, China and the East and the US, the balance will be changing. And in Europe, we are in the middle. And I will almost say stuck in the middle. But I really foresee that if we do not cooperate as a very big, interesting area, we are losing grip. And it's really difficult for the Europeans to work closely together. We are really proud of our port in the Netherlands. And the port in Rotterdam is owned for 50% by the Chinese people. And we are very proud of having, you know, this really gate to Europe. But there are much more gates coming up. So how do we do this? We do not really foresee the long term and acting based maybe on politics, but based in the very short term, which might be dangerous. So I foresee big differences in the market, and complete other difference in the market, in my opinion, is the way customers are acting. But I strongly believe that nowadays customers are in the lead. And we have to act like that. We have to follow the customers. They, you know, if you want to buy something, whatever it is, your research, you know, from first thought about a new product or service till the moment you buy, your research, you do it on Google in 5 minutes. So, in my belief, every company has to change its model towards a very customer experience-based model. And then in the bigger part, the world is very, very, very good connected. So wherever you buy your product is not an issue anymore. So we can do a lot, but please put the customer on place one. So that I think these are two, you know, the big one and the small one as a customer, two very big differences we have to face.
I completely agree. In terms of entrepreneurial skills, because I believe we cannot all work for the government, for the public administration, or working for multinationals. I believe we need to have more entrepreneurs coming up, you know, startup companies, coming up with new ideas, new thinking, and just especially these millennials that have this leisure way to be, you know. What do you believe? What are the skills an entrepreneur, a young entrepreneur today needs to have or to master?
I think that there is a part of, let's say, the entrepreneurial skills. There are a lot, but I think the creativity is a very important one. I think the being resilient, being flexible in doing the things you do is very important. I think you have, you still, as an entrepreneur, you still will be the generalist. But this means that you have to know a lot, actually. And knowing a lot means that you at least have to have a certain level of knowledge, of experience in ICT, in automation, in maybe marketing or business automation, these kinds of things. So maybe these three are, let's say, part of the three business skills you need in the new world, in the new entrepreneurial world. And besides that, building your network, knowing the people you need at a certain moment, and where to find them, knowing where to find them is very important. Yeah.
Thank you. What is a good leader from your point of view? What makes a person a leader?
I think I explained it in the beginning already a little bit, but for me, a good leader is someone who is helping his team forward. So not the person who wants to win or manage the company, but helping his team to the next stage or to the next phase. So in my belief, the leader is not the one who is, let's say, always mentioned as the best one in the company, but he is the one who creates the best team and gives his team the opportunity to win and to be successful. Not steering, steering, but you know, standing behind and not going on at the first place. So I think that's a really big difference between management, you manage the company, and leadership, where you say, hey, I think you should do something else because your talent is somewhere else. And then that's a really big difference. So having the opportunity to create the best team and create the best out of your team members, I think that's leading company leadership. Yeah.
Amazing. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, any questions to our guests?
We talked a little bit about sustainability in the beginning of your talk. And I want to ask you, how do you move forward with a company that's very bottom line driven and maybe not as concerned with environmental impacts or sustainability or something like that? How do you convince them?
It's a good question, and it's very difficult to convince people. I think there was a moment 2.5 years ago which changed the view on sustainability really a lot, and this was the moment the US American President Donald Trump explained that he did not believe in the global warming. And from that moment, this is weird actually, but from that moment you saw that different governors in the states in the US, but worldwide, there was a reaction against his decision. And from that moment, every company knows that you have to do something about sustainability. That's the first thing. We won this part, you know, in time, which is already very late if you are working from 2015 with the global goals 2030. You know, we're halfway already, but okay, we won at this moment. Secondly, in the beginning, most of the companies were expecting that being sustainable was expensive. But there is a huge difference at this moment, and that's the customer again. Because if you take a look at customer needs, then customer do more and more not agree with the, let's say, the non-sustainable activities in the value chain of a company. So for example, if we take a look at production of clothing, and we talk about laborers and the children in Asia, then there are more and more people who do not want to buy those kind of clothes. If you take a look at different aspects, then you see that people are more and more arguing the, let's say, the bad decisions of companies. And for me, you know, I have a small company and I'm traveling all over Europe in a big plane, which is polluting all over the world. And then I have to make a decision. Do I, yes or do I no, travel in a plane? And then there is a very, let's say, for me, a critical one, which I explain to people, that you have to create impact. And sometimes you cannot do everything in the best way, but try to find the balance between doing the utmost to be sustainable. And sometimes you have to drive in a polluting truck or go by a plane or do something else. And then you see that the companies are more and more realizing that there is an opportunity to change, and they are willing to change, but they have to see that there is, you know, an advantage for the company. I will show you something, because it's not that I expected this question, but I think it's very good to show. You see it now, I guess. It's a model I use very lot of times, because if you see the model, the historical model of a company, then you have to choose for the cheapest product, for the best, logistical way of bringing the goods, or the customer value. And I strongly believe that if you take a look at, and now you see my arrow, I guess, huh? You see it moving. Mm-hmm. If you take a look at this part, you see that every business has to have a healthy business operation. That's for sure. And secondly, and now I have to move a little bit. Yeah, there we're going. It's the remarkable customer experience, which is really important. Okay, this is, yes, let's say, the usual way of doing business. But the other part is creating a positive social impact. And we see more and more companies explaining their positive, way of creating social impact. For example, if you take a look at the, let's say, the big banking companies in the Netherlands, you see that they have a social yearly report. A few years ago, you saw only, let's say, the annual report, and a second report was the social one. Now you see the combination of it. And there are more and more tools coming up to measure impact. I think it's very important to, let's say, to create a way of thinking in the bigger companies. So I agree that's very difficult, but creating a way to show that they can bring extra added value to the customer based on sustainability gives a lot of opportunities to companies. And the ones who are really fast in this are the really, the exponential growers and maybe the new millennials or whatever it is. But I'm always explaining that if you take a look at students, they are much more sustainable than the lecturers in the educational institutes. Yeah. Because as students, you share your bicycle, or you go by bus, or tram, or metro, and we want to drive in our car. Yeah, why? Yeah. So there is a change coming up, and I think we have to help those people. But we are really helped by, let's say, the change in behavior worldwide. Thank a long you. Question, but I hope I answered you.
Okay. No, thank you. It was really helpful.
Okay. I have two questions, actually.
Good.
So the first one is when you need to train a team that has different cultures. So you have a team that you need to train on a specific task or a specific goal, but they come from different backgrounds. How do you do? How do you plan and how do you operate to achieve the best possible result?
Well, good question again, of course, I would say, but it's a difficult one too. I do not specifically think about it, but it might be because of, some experiences. I strongly believe, and I always start with, profiling the team members. So the first step is, what kind of persons do you have? And if you take a look at Meyer Briggs, you see that in a lot of cultures, For example, the only way of the difference between extrovert and introvert means that in a team, you have to take a look at the introvert people, especially because they will not say anything if you don't ask them. So that's one thing. It's not yet the culture, but it's the inner side of persons. And a second thing in the balance of four values of MBTI is the way of, how you said it, the way of acting inside here. If people say, if people ask me a question, I can give an answer in a few seconds. Mm-hmm. But there are lots of people who say, well, I don't know, and they have to think about it. So the way of the production here of information and translating it to an answer is really different. And this is also different in cultures. So for me, it's not really, at the first place, not really the cultural issue, but it's the typology of people, how people are, you know, are how people are, and the way right. of how people are is, let's say, translated in the way of communication. Mm-hmm. And the way of communicate can be very different in different cultures. So
right.
it's based on the inside, but then you see, and that's what I see by, let's say, doing thousands of tests already all over Europe. I see in Europe already differences in profiling. In, let's say the number of types are, and the introvert types are, for example, in Scandinavia, much more represented than in the Netherlands. And so you see differences in typologies, and it might be translated, possible to translate it to differences mm-hmm. in cultures. Yeah. Yeah. But okay. you have two questions.
Thank you. Yes. the second one. Oh, okay. The second one is a bit more on a self-interest base, let's say. Yes. So I did your 16 personality test, one you recommended on Edinburgh, and I did it multiple times, and I keep getting two different results, but always the same two. So I wanted to ask you, what does that mean? I keep getting either protagonist or commander. Depending on the mood, the results change.
Well, you know, if you take a look at the let's say the Myers-Briggs research they did, mm-hmm. And I think it's also stated in the 16 personalities test you did over there,
yeah.
You see that every personality has a growth profile. Mm-hm. So it's not true that you have one profile and that's for the rest of your life. Mm-hmm. Your profile. So I think that's an important one to know. And if you take a look to the, let's say, the research Myers-Briggs did, you see that by certain types, there is always a first line growth profile and a second one. So it's not so strange that it might change a little bit. But there's another thing. And if you say it depends on the mood and it's already one and then the other, and then we're back to the other one, then it's not a growth profile.
Right.
Let's do it again with an example. If we have extrovert and introvert,
right.
There are some people, let's say, on a scale 1 out of 10, 10 points extrovert. On the other, you know, on the big line, there is, on that big line, you have extrovert, but you also have the extreme introvert.
Right.
So it's one or another. And at the end, in the results you read, you have one or another. But if you read just a little bit lower, you see mm-hmm. that you might not be 100% extrovert, but you can be, let's say, 51% and 49% of the other.
Right.
And in that case, it's only one different answer and it gives a complete profile. So it might be, and I have to check the, let's say, the commander and the protagonist exactly in detail mm-hmm. to show where it is. But you can read in the documentation, mm-hmm. you can read where the percentages are on the four lines. And if you take a look at that, then it must be that on one of the four, and maybe more, but on one of the four lines, you're really a little bit in the middle of two extremes. So one time on the other side of the line and one time on the other side of the line. Mm-hmm. And if you say it's then it's a protagonist, the next time it's a commander, and then it's a protagonist again, then you're really close to those two profiles. And if you take a look at the let's say at the description of the profiles, you will see that there are not so many differences between those.
In fact, that's what I find interesting, because both description actually match me in different ways, but they both describe me.
that's why we brought in a second test, a talent scan, just looking at a huge number of talents, because there is one thing you are, let's say, based on the Myers-Briggs outcomes, you are a certain personality, but then you can, you know, at the inside, you can have, you can be talented for some things and not talented for other things. And altogether, I think there is a very specific view of who you are translated to what you can do the best. And then it makes it really interesting, because if you are the, let's say, if you are the commander, you are the entrepreneur, you are the leader, you have some skills which are really recommended, but it will not mean that you, in the task you have to do on a certain moment, are really good in all the tasks you have to do.
Right.
So you are learning how you, let's say, how you can, maybe give the task where you're not talented in to someone else, for example. Find someone who can do it better. You know, that's I am, you know, I really like the things I do, like being here, for example. But if you now say we have a meeting next week, 2-hour meeting, then my first thing is 2 hours, why not 15 minutes? You know, it's crazy. And if I have to lead a meeting, I will not make minutes. I will not make notes. I don't send it because I don't like it. It's so far away from me. So if I'm in the lead in a meeting, someone else has to make the notes. This is great. This works great. Sure. So yeah, there are more things, but hopefully this was an answer on your questions.
Yeah. Luca. Then,
I have a question, mm-hmm. because you don't see her, but she's here.
Yeah. Hi. Yeah.
But her question is, what are the stages of a company starting, like as an entrepreneur? Like, when should you be focusing on the social impact, but still be focusing on being successful and making a profit?
Making a profit is, I think, always part of the business. Otherwise, maybe you are a social entrepreneur and say, well, I do something else and I don't have to make money, but at the end, you have to cover your costs always. So the stages, there are lots of stages, and I think there is a model, and I think it's the Greiner model, maybe you know it. There are 9 or 12 stages in a company, and but let's focus on the first ones. I think in the first stage, when you are in the startup phase, I think it's just testing the market. It's just trying, getting your minimum viable product and try to sell. And in the startup phase, 80% of your business you have to fill with selling your product and your services. And all the rest is a second thing you have to do, but not a priority. Priority is selling your product and talking with your customers and trying to upgrade your own product to the next level. And then it becomes really difficult, because when I stepped in my company, in Network, the name was changed in Network Solution. When I stepped in that company, I started with 18 people and I grew in the first year to 30 people, which is quite easy because you have reached a certain level. I think the biggest, the biggest challenge in starting your business is growing to a level which is really still small, but growing to a level where you don't have to be worried about your cash flow position every week or every month. And if you reach that, you can think about growing. And then the first step in growing is hiring someone. which is really difficult in the beginning because that's expensive, because you're really happy that you make some money. And then you have to hire someone who is more expensive than you are. It's crazy. But these steps are really difficult. And the first steps in, let's say, starting up, and I must say, if I take a look to my own company, let's say the AdWork solutions nowadays started maybe 4 years ago. I think I have struggled a lot in the new setting to find a really good product. And I can tell you, I'm building again, because I have a really good product. And then I'm visiting Rome, as we discussed earlier with your president. I should visit Rome and I should give a training, should take you, as I did in Edinburgh, but then focused on the individuals. And then halfway March, my world was completely changed also. And I have to think again, and I have to create a new product, and I have to rebuild everything I did, which is, you know, possible, and which is a really good advantage, because I was just thinking about scaling up, which means, I have to sell more in every country. I have to build my, let's say, my a more solid playground to develop and to get the developments paid and building the apps and so on. So I had to change my strategy in the last weeks or months, and I'm changing now, and it took time to it. And you know, talking about internationalization, so talking about global management, might be global leadership, I changed my way of internationalization completely, really completely. I turned around 100%, and I'm now working it out with some people, working it out and building again. So in that first phase, there is a very, let's say, difficult and tough start to make, which is a really interesting phase. But, you know, most entrepreneurs have their passion for the product or service and passion for the company. You can explain it. But it's really difficult to get on the level that you can sit back and think, okay, now it's running. What's the next step? You know, that's really a big phase. And if you come to the other steps, and you should take a look at the Greiner, Greiner model, because in every phase, from the first to the second, and from the eighth to the ninth, and so on, every phase starts with lots of issues in the company. And the Greiner model explains what the issues will be, so you can recognize this phase. And at the end, it also explains what you can do about it.
Yeah, we use in leadership a book of Marshall Goldsmith called "What Got You Here Won't Get You There," because you cannot apply the same strategy from where you started on a startup phase and then from a grown-up in enterprise that has to change and unfortunately react or even anticipate the market. They're completely different strategies, completely different games. Fantastic, Rob. Yeah. Let me ask you the last question. So, Professor Rob DeWitt, what would you recommend the new generation of leaders? What should they focus on? What should they concentrate on? $1 million question.
it looks like that. Yeah. Thank you very much for this question. It's behind me. Focus on those three topics. Not one, not only the financials. Not two, not the financials and your customers. But really focus on three of these, but especially on the third one too, on the impact you can create. Because every single customer wants to be impacted, or you know, wants to feel the impact you can create with your company or in the company you're working. So creating impact is maybe the key word and the key solution and the key direction in the next year. So I think that's a short one, actually, a short answer. But let's say creating impact and be aware of, and that's the thing that's for me really difficult, but I have to do it, but be aware of getting the things automated when you feel that you have to do every time the same things. So automation in every issue is so rapidly evolving. Use that. Yeah.
Amazing. Rob David, thank you very much for being with us with your wisdom, experience, and your talent. Thank you very much. Please switch on your microphones. We give him a big hand.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you very much. It was really a pleasure and an honor to be part of this this course. And all the best in the course. All from home probably, but all the best in this course and a lot of success in the future.
Thank you so much, Rob.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.